I don't know why I couldn't hear that, but welcome to the Wolf Den Podcast. How are we all doing today? We have a wacky one. Hello. We got, look at this setup we got going on. Yep. How's everybody? I hope you're good. Listen, man. I haven't filmed all day. What time did I get this thing? I got this thing at 10 a.m.
Damn.
So, we've been hard at work making some videos. Well, one video. It's really just been one video.
But it will be multiple videos.
Today, yes. After this, yes, it will be multiple videos. Also, in the rush over to get everything set up for this, I spilled water all over my Xbox One. So, I guess I do need upgrade after all.
Yeah, so... You were just going to throw out your Xbox One anyway, so...
Yeah, it was garbage anyway. Yeah, okay. So anyway, how is everybody doing? How are you? Special hello. Oh, we got a bunch of stuff right now. Already, right off the bat. We got... Who do we got? We got Rocket Val with 5 months. 19 months? Since 5 months. Oh my god. Keep up the amazing work, my friends. Hope everyone is well. Thank you, Rocket Val. Appreciate yous. Phantasmagore, thanks you for the 3 months. The Red Queen 316, thank you for the 20 months. Nick T official, thank you for the 4 months. Oh hey, it's my favorite tubeubers, that's not how you say it, Bill and Pop Dog. Oh god, from the channel Dog Cave. I hate you.
That's very incorrect.
I hate you, but thank you for your money. Triton, that one guy with 10 months. Hey Wolf Bros, how's it going? Hello. Di Colazzo with 8 months. Windows noises. Happy 8 months, Bobby. I love you, man. Were there Windows noises? Oh, yeah, I left my desktop audio on. Chris BX, thank you for the 28 months. Amandowski, thank you for the 11. Bob, happy 11 months. Also, what do you think my chances are for snagging PS5 on launch day? Not great.
Yeah, pretty bad, actually, and we'll get to that as we get into later in the show.
Yeah, we have
there's a caveat with getting PS5s on launch day.
Yeah, it's not looking good, basically. Yeah. Set alerts for yourself. We'll talk about it later. Chris BX, thank you for the 28 months. I said that already. Boomer Shroom, thank you for the 8. Thank you for the 22 months. Ethel, thanks for the 15 months. BB Retro, how you doing? Good to see you. Thanks for the 4 months. I love you so much. Now, what do you say? I fire this bad boy up.
Oh boy, let's do it.
I should have put the mic
up
to it. It
sounds just like an Xbox One.
I know, and it looks like an Xbox One, but weird looking, you know.
It's like squat.
I think the wackiest is how tiny this is, the S.
Oh, you did get the S.
I did get the S. This is actually not my S. I did get an S, and it is coming today.
Right.
From FedEx, so probably not, but it says that it is. This is Jackson's. This is Scootish's PlayStation 1 Series S.
Okay.
It is very tiny though. It is like shockingly tiny. Even if when you take it out of the box, the box is like twice the size of the.
Yeah, I was watching Microsoft's official unboxing videos for both of them, and I got worse to say about that. and it looks, you know, very minuscule compared to the monolith that is the X. I haven't seen a lot of pictures of people putting a GameCube on top of the X, and it's like the perfect size.
That's the thing. The X, I think, looks bigger than it actually is. The X is really not big at all.
Yeah. Because I've also seen a lot of people easily put it into their entertainment center, easily fit it into, like, you know, the drawers and the cabinets and stuff.
Yeah,
whereas the PlayStation 5, everyone's like, nope.
It's a little deceptive.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. The PS5 is going to be way bigger than this.
Yeah.
I also got a little shelf for myself over here for all my new consoles. Because I'm not going to have any room on my desk with all these new consoles. We should also show off the controller. Here's the controller.
It now
looks identical.
So how does it feel like to hold? Because I know it's smaller than the Xbox One controller.
Really?
But by like a hair.
You know, when I took it out of the box, it looked like when it was all wrapped up, I was like, wow, that's small for an Xbox controller. But it looks exactly the same. And it feels exactly the same.
Okay. Because like everything I've read said like it's a hair smaller, but like you can feel a difference.
Now that you mention it, it is a hair smaller. But yeah, it's not, I wouldn't call it a significant change.
How's the weight? Is the weight any different?
The weight is good. Actually, I don't have batteries in this other one. That's another thing. It takes the same rechargeable battery.
Yeah.
So if you have the rechargeable battery pack, you could just pop it in here.
Yeah. And I know so, it has trigger grips, but I heard those are useless.
Trigger grips? What do you mean?
Like there are bumps on the trigger.
On the trigger? Oh yeah, there are.
Yeah.
There are those. Yeah, those are. I mean, it feels nice.
Yeah, it's got.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of the glossy triggers on the Xbox One controller.
Yeah,
mine's got gunk. Is that just sweat? Yeah, it's probably just sweat. That's gross. The finish is very different. You can kind of see it.
Yeah,
like it's more matte, and it's got a little sparkle in it.
That's that next gen sparkle.
There you go. It doesn't look exactly the same as the console itself.
Huh.
It's weird. It's very weird. Yeah. But at first glance, it looks exactly like it. But yeah, when you get close to it, it looks a little lighter, a little sparklier. Also, this console, fingerprint magnet. If you got greasy fingers.
That's
if you got greasy fingers, going to be fingerprints all over it.
Yeah.
Otherwise, everything's the same. The D-pad, this is a shock, I actually like the D-pad.
Really?
So I like the D-pad on the regular Xbox One controller. It's very clicky.
Yeah. The one on the Xbox One controller is a traditional D-pad. This one is modeled after the Elite Series controller D-pad, and it's kind of like a disc, but for this one, they, like the actual plus sign, they raise so that you can actually feel that.
Did they raise it more than the Elite?
Yeah, because the Elite, I think, is just a disc.
It really does. The fact that it's raised feels really good. And it's clickier, believe it or not.
Yeah, I think it was Engadget said this is a very clicky controller.
Listen to this.
Yeah.
That's me just rotating around the D-pad. It feels really good. Other than that, you also have the share button in the middle. That's new. That makes it so that you accidentally share things all the time when you want to go to either the home screen or the start screen. But that's something that you'll probably end up getting used to.
Yeah, because like the Xbox One desperately needed a share button because doing so without a Kinect was not intuitive, as opposed to the PlayStation 4, which literally had a share button on it.
I feel like with the PlayStation 4, we accidentally shared things a lot, too.
I feel like I shared less on the not like accidentally. Like, I intentionally, if I wanted to share something, I would intentionally share it. Whereas on the Xbox One, I shared things a lot less because I had to hold the Xbox guide button, press whatever button to save a screenshot or whatever. I'll tell you what, I hit that stupid trackpad all the time on the PS4, though.
Yes, yes.
I think so. Stupid.
Well, I mean, we got used to that eventually.
Yeah.
I feel like we'll get used to the home button. I mean, the share button being where it is on here.
Yeah, I think so.
Otherwise, everything's pretty much exactly the same. Mm-hmm. But it's a very nice... It was always a very nice controller. So it has the dimples on the back, which is cool.
Yeah, I like that. Both controllers now have... The PS5 and the Series X have a grip on the handles, which I think is good.
Yeah, it's a very nice controller. I mean, but they didn't have to change much. Mm-hmm. And the Series S comes with a white one. And I kind of like the
robot
white one more.
Robot white, it's called.
It looks like concrete, dude. It looks very slick. Now, I also have the PS5 controller here. Look at how much bluer the PS5 controller looks.
That's insane.
Doesn't that look like almost blue?
Yeah, I'm surprised like how huge the PS5 controller is. I mean, I guess everything with the PlayStation 5 is going to be big, but the DualSense I mean, you're holding them like on top of each other, but I still get the sense that the DualSense is like substantially bigger than the Series S controller.
Yeah, no, it's bigger, dude.
Yeah.
It juts out a little more to the sides.
Yeah.
Which is crazy because the PS4 controller was tiny.
Yeah.
It was still
bigger than the DualShock 3, but
it's tiny, tiny little controller.
Yeah.
So yeah, I'm a fan of the controller situation. Yeah. What do you want to see here, Will? What do you want to see?
I want to see something running 4K, 120 frames per second with ray tracing and HDR and 3D. So put on your glasses, kids. They still make games in 3D, right?
That's just too bad, Will, because this is a 1080p stream. Also, what freaking games are there right now that are going to be 4K, 120 frames? Zero.
I think Gears 5. That might just be 120 frames per second. I don't know about 4K.
So I played... Is that on Game Pass?
Yes.
Ooh, I'm going to be downloading that then. I'm going to be downloading that. So I played Rainbow Six. Mm-hmm. Because that is 120 frames, or at least they said it was 120 frames. It's like barely a difference.
Really?
Yeah, at 1080p, 120 frames. It's like I was expecting to be blown away because that's everybody said I was going to be blown away.
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't really blown away. It was like, all right, this is cool. And then I got called a slur by a 4-year-old. I'm not even kidding. I got team killed twice,
mm-hmm.
and then the guy called me a slur.
He
invited me to his party and then called me a slur and then kicked me out of the party.
So the thing about frame rates is that the higher up you go, it's common for people to be less and less susceptible to it. Mm-hmm. So like, you know, normally people can tell this between 30 and 60. When you start getting up to 120 and then like 240 eventually, the difference is like, you know, the chances of you noticing a difference become less and less common. So mm-hmm. The game might be running in full 120, but like you can't really perceive a difference between that and 60 in like regular gameplay.
I guess it's like the law of diminishing returns.
Yeah, something like that. It's the same thing with resolution. As that gets, you know, larger and larger, you're going to see less and less of a difference.
Well, I was expecting it to be like, you know, when you're watching when I see a 60 frames per second video, I go, oh, it must be 60 frames. Like, I can tell. And the same thing with 30 frames. I go, oh, this is 34, this is 24 frames. Like, I could tell all that. But with 120 frames, I don't think, if you showed me 120 frames versus 60, I don't think I would be able to instantly tell the difference.
Yeah. According to the official Xbox page for Gears 5, it is running in 4K at 120 frames per second.
Oh, I guess I got to... check that out. I mean, is that if it's on Game Pass, then
it's on Game Pass. Yeah,
when did that come out?
Microsoft first party titles go to Game Pass day and date with launch of the actual game, so it's available now.
Is Halo 5, is that 4K 120? Because I have a save file on that already.
The Master Chief Collection might be.
Because, you know, whenever I test these games out, there's always, you gotta get through all the garbage in the beginning before you actually see any real differences.
It's not saying what the enhancements are for Series X for Master Chief Collection. But yeah, definitely try Gears, because I know Gears of War is always like, you know, the benchmark game for like graphical fidelity and whatnot, mm-hmm. even dating back to the 360. So I would definitely download that and give that a try.
So currently I only have 4 games downloaded on here. I have, I'll do it in order of what I downloaded. Rainbow Six Siege, because I knew that would be 120 frames and I needed to see it in 120 frames. Call of Duty Warzone, which I'm excited to see if it has 120 frames. I don't think it does. I was actually surprised that I got it on here, because I couldn't search for it. Then it said that I had it already. I had to download it from my own library because I guess it still considers it an Xbox One game.
Yeah, your library is going to carry over. And from my understanding, you just re-download it like you would re-download it on an Xbox One.
Correct. I mean, this UI looks exactly like the Xbox One UI.
Yeah.
Yeah, you just go to all games owned like this, and these are all the games I own, and I can just download whatever I want.
Yeah.
Anyway, so I have Siege, which I got from Game Pass. Modern Warzone, I'm sorry. Sonic Adventure 2, the Xbox 360 game that had a save file from my Xbox 360 days. Mm-hmm. And Star Wars Jedi Knight Jedi Academy for original Xbox. So we are
testing all generations.
Wait a minute. On Call of Duty Warzone, it has the X/S on it.
That must... all right, let me go back to the optimized list. Because maybe that means it's optimized for X and S.
Go to official... So, then why wouldn't Siege have that? Why wouldn't Rainbow Six have that?
It's Call of Duty Black Ops Cold War is going to be optimized.
Yes, I will be playing that on this, probably.
Wait, hold on a second. Because I remember seeing... I forgot where it was. There's an article that will tell you whether or not a game is optimized or not on the Xbox itself.
I would like to know that. That would be a good thing to indicate to people.
All right. Give me a minute. I will find it. In the meantime, I had questions and articles about hard drive space, but since you only downloaded 4 games, I will not be asking you how the hard drive space is on these systems.
I currently have 651 gigabytes free. Right. And I think it's of note that I do have Warzone on here.
Yes. And Warzone's so, like what, 150?
It's like 200 something. Yeah. But it might download. You know what? I should open it. I have it muted, so
yeah.
You won't hear it. But it let's see if it has to update more. Oh, here we go. It's doing stuff. This might break my Elgato. So I have the Xbox set to 1080p 120 frames. Because the monitor we were using to shoot just now does 120 frames. So I was specifically looking for 120 frames. Update requires restart. Okay.
So you set that at the system level?
Yes.
Okay.
I set it on, yes.
Okay. Do the games themselves have basically graphical options?
So Siege had FreeSync as an option. No. Mm-hmm. It had VSync as an option. It was just yes or no. It wasn't like cool PC type settings. Warzone has really deep graphical settings for consoles. I haven't checked it. I haven't even opened it on this yet. So this is the first time I'm opening it now. Grizzo says the X/S logo at the bottom, the icon means it's optimized for Series X/S. So then why the hell didn't Siege have it? Maybe Siege isn't optimized? I have it on my one. Maybe I should see if that also has a VSync option. Install the high resolution detector.
It's coming soon. It's not out yet.
What's not out
yet? On the Xbox official list of optimized games, Rainbow Six Siege is listed as coming soon. So maybe that's why you didn't notice 120 frames per second, because it's not in 120 frames per second.
All right, boys, scrap the whole video. Yeah. Wrap it up.
Yeah?
Rainbow Six Siege isn't optimized for Series X yet. Don't look at me like that.
Are you serious?
Wait. Do you seriously?
I have E and Brady out there working on the video right now. What do you want from me?
I don't know whether or not to believe you.
I mean, you could have said something, you know?
How am I supposed to know? This is your video. I'm here.
So I got to basically, I got to download. He says hi.
I will.
Basically, I got to download Gears 5.
Yeah. Seriously? Get Gears 5.
So we got to try Gears 5.
There was another.
Looks like barely. Get out of here. Go. I'm doing a podcast.
All right, great. Quit. Fuck you, Bob. Kill
the dog. Yes, Will.
I forgot there's another game on Game Pass that's like a good test for frame rate. I forgot the name of it. It's like the Falconeer or like Flight of the Falcon. It's something where you fly a bird.
Oh, the Falconeer. Yeah.
Yeah, that one.
Yeah, but that game doesn't look like good.
I know.
No, I mean, it looks good. I'm just saying it looks like an indie game. You know, it's not like. It's
right.
Not like
no, yeah,
I'm going to be getting the cool, like, freaking ray tracing and whatnot.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. What's this? Game installs. Delta Pack 1. This pack is required to access campaign. I don't care.
Oh, does it still think you're connected to Modern Warfare?
Maybe. High resolution texture pack 1. Any game required to play any game mode. That's all I care. Okay, then do that. All right, cool. So I got it down. Luckily, all this stuff downloaded really quick. Also, when I set it up, everybody was freaking out today because the servers were down.
Mm-hmm.
But mine's set up, downloaded the update within 10 minutes. The whole thing was set up within 10 minutes.
Did you set it up using your phone? Because they made a big deal about you can use the Xbox app on your phone to set it up.
I was excited for that.
Mm-hmm.
But I think I passed that screen and it doesn't let you go back to it.
Really?
So I did it with the controller. But all it did was ask me to log into my Xbox account, and I did that on my phone. Like, you can go to like live.com or whatever.
Yeah.
And you know how, like, when you're setting up Netflix or YouTube on a TV, you can
go to
a website
to, like,
on your phone.
YouTube.com/activate. Yeah.
I did that. So instead of using the Xbox app, I just did that.
Okay.
All right. So now I'm downloading another 23 gigabytes. Cool, dude. Great. Thank
all right. While we're talking about storage space, so now that everybody's got the new consoles and they're trying to figure out like the SSDs, because they all have a terabyte of storage space except for the Series S, which has half that, 512. I'm not talking to you, Siri. I'm talking about the Series S.
Mm-hmm.
Go away, that, phone.
That'll happen.
Okay, so the Xbox One X has 802 gigabytes of usable space. 198 gigs are reserved for system files and whatnot. The Series S, however, only has 364 gigabytes of available storage space, mm-hmm. with 148 gigs reserved for the consoles OS and whatnot. That's bad.
Yes.
That's like right now. I almost bought a Series S today because it was on Amazon and I could click it into my cart, but I hesitated because that's a very small amount of storage space for 2020 playing games in 2020. Like,
yeah,
that's one indie. That's one AAA game and like a handful of indie games. And I mean, if you think about it, if you can get the Seagate expansion cards for like $200, but at that point you just spend the money and get a One X.
Yeah,
a Series X rather.
That's what I have in my video. I say that it's 500 gigabytes for the S, and if you want to upgrade later, it's $220 for the Seagate drive.
Yeah.
And that's more than it would have cost to just get this. And all you're getting is 500 gigabytes more if you add it all up.
Yeah.
So that's kind of not really worth it.
Yeah. I mean, at this point, the Series S is really, it's basically just a secondary console. It's like, if you want to, if you want to have the main Xbox and then like your kid or your casual playing sibling or partner or whatever want to play games occasionally, they get the Series S while you get the Series X. Or like if you're primarily a PlayStation player but you want to play an Xbox game here and there, then you get the Series S. I will say though, two things. Xbox has what they're calling velocity architecture.
Oh, would you like to interrupt the podcast? Yes.
It's not our fault. It's CS Coach Jackson's fault because he was the one that told you.
Siege. Yes, you're right. Jackson told me he read on Reddit that Siege is 120 frames and that the update is available. And what did I say to him?
That's so specific.
I said, that's a very specific thing for you to have remembered, Jackson.
He said, I'm one of the subs.
What'd he say?
He said, oh, I'm one of the subs.
Oh, I'm one of the subs. I love Rainbow Six Siege. That's what he said. So I was wrong. So I can't be crapping all over him, but he was also wrong. Send this clip to Scootish now.
Let the dog out of here. You know what you should do? You should break his Series S.
Oh, that'll be fun.
That would be fun. Also, we lost picture.
That's because I made fun of Scootish.
Okay.
Son of a bitch.
So what I was saying, Xbox is touting what they call velocity architecture, which should know the difference between a Series S and a Series X and won't download all the 4K textures and whatnot, so that you could theoretically end up with a smaller file size on the Series S than you would on the X.
I was watching our good friend Kevin Kenson, and yes. I think it was Assassin's Creed Valhalla. It was only like 9 gigabytes smaller on the S. So it's not like that will definitely help and is definitely useful because you don't need high res textures on the S.
Yeah.
It's just, it's not as big of a help as we would hope.
Right.
I mean, I just downloaded the high res texture pack for Call of Duty. It was 23 gigs. The game so far is 104 gigs. So you're going to add 23 gigs on top of that. I feel like it's going to be bigger, a lot bigger than this, though.
Yeah.
This seems a little too tiny.
Also, both systems, the Series S and the Series X, you can plug in external hard drives to it, and you can store Series S and Series X games on the external hard drive. You just can't play them off of the external hard drive.
Yes.
You'd have to transfer them onto the internal hard drive in order to play them. And my understanding is the transfer speeds are actually not that slow. So to go back and forth, it doesn't take that long. You can theoretically be gaming within a couple of minutes if you do go down that route. But you just have to be able to, you know, juggle your memory a little bit better.
I'll be honest, I'm a little impressed with how quickly this thing downloads games.
Yeah.
Like it's, and I got it on Wi-Fi. I'm not even hardwired in. It's doing a really good job, you know? So I'm not too worried about speeds. That's not something you need to worry about here.
Yeah. Well, the whole thing with this system generation is that they're running off of SSDs, which just eliminate loading times and just increase the speed of the system overall.
The only thing, is juggling storage. I said that the S is for people who maybe buy one or two games a year. Maybe they're the Call of Duty or Madden people or the FIFA people. Or they're people who will upgrade when there's a mid-generation iteration.
Right.
But like a 1X.
Yeah.
Then they will decide that they want 4K all of a sudden, and then they will jump on it. But I mean, if your intention is to get the S and then eventually get drive,
the
Seagate drive. If your intention is to get the S and then eventually get that Seagate drive, it might be a waste of money.
Yeah.
You're probably better off just if you have an Xbox One of any sort, keep that for a little bit because there's nothing on these things right now that you can't play on those. So there are
even Halo Infinite will work on an Xbox One. So
there are currently there's a lot of launch titles, actually. There's I can't show it on screen, but there's a lot. Oh wait, I can. Nah, it'll be really tiny. There's a lot of launch titles right now. There's a lot of games that you can play on it right now. However, of all of these, only four of them are exclusives, and all of those four are also on PC. So they're not really exclusives.
Yeah.
So I sympathize with early adopters because I have one. So like, I say you'll get it eventually, so why not just get it now?
Yeah.
So like, I get it if you want one. And there's people who don't have a console at all. Maybe they're just really hyped for something like this, and that's totally fine. But if you're looking to upgrade, you can take your time. It's really not gonna blow your mind, you know. I mean, maybe Assassin's Creed Valhalla, but like, I don't need to spend $500 to see a couple extra rocks on the ground, you know.
Yeah.
Did you see the way that light went through his hair? Like,
yeah,
you're getting the same game both ways. It's going to be the same gameplay experience.
Going back to storage space for a second, I wanted to bring up the Xbox storage space situation because they're also talking about the PlayStation 5 storage space. Now, the PlayStation 5 actually does have a slightly smaller internal storage. It has like 800 something gigs. It's not a true terabyte of storage. And of that, only 667 gigs are usable. So it's even less. And not only that, but as of right now, I mean, as of the launch of the PS5, which is this week, there is no way to offload that. The PS5 currently does not support either external hard drives or adding an NVMe drive to the PS5, which is what the big selling point of the PS5 was, that you can use any NVMe solid state drive on the PS5. That feature is not supported at launch, and neither is using external hard drives.
Also, 1440p doesn't work.
1440p also is not supported.
I think they said it will be supported eventually. Yeah, Sony's actually pretty good with doing updates, but yeah, it could take up to a month.
Clear, they will patch in support for external hard drives and external NVMe drives. And like the Series X, you can load PS5 games off of the NVMe drive and store them on the external hard drive, and you can play and store PS4 games on the external hard drive. But I mean, if you ask me, not supporting that at launch is a pretty big deal, because I mean, if you're coming over from the PS4 and you have a library of games that you want to load on this new hard drive in addition to all the PS5 games, you know, you're not going to be able to. It's going to be a problem.
Yeah. They promised a lot of people are making they're making big decisions on which console they're going to end up with, and
yeah,
some of those decisions include things like that NVMe drive and having more storage space, and maybe their TV is, maybe they have a monitor that's 1440p. So people are making these decisions, and Sony is like, oh, not yet, you'll get it eventually, just calm yourself. Yeah. You're not gonna get it right now. So that's a kind of a big deal, and also a little bit, a smattering of false advertising. A little sprinkling of false advertising there.
Yeah.
Yandahas in the chat says, correction, you can plug in an external drive to play PS4 games at launch. You just can't stick any PS5 games on an external. Yeah, but like...
Okay. But still, the fact remains that like, there's currently no external storage solution for PS5 games. The only place that they can be stored is on the system's hard drive itself, which at, you know, 667 gigs, that's going to fill up pretty quickly. Also apparently not supported on PlayStation 5 right now is any way to back up your saves other than uploading them to the cloud. And cloud save backup, much like on the Switch, requires a PlayStation Plus account.
Yikes.
That's That's troubling.
So when I switch everything over on my PS5, can I just download all of my saves?
As long as you're a member of PS Plus, yeah, you just go into whatever menu it is and just download all your saves.
Okay. We're backed up on some notifications here. 72107 with 100 bits. Nothing better than chilling out with my favorite bros after a week of night shifts. Hope you're good. I'm good. How are you? Will, how are you?
I'm all right. I got a burp coming, so that's what I'm dealing with.
Atif Ruki, 5 months. Hey, Bob and Will. Bob, I've fallen over your comment on my vid. Atif Faruqi made a video on the Porsche. Is it a Taycan?
Cayenne?
The Porsche, the electric one.
Oh.
It was a good video. And I was amazed at how he could remember all of his lines. Jess the Vagabond with 2 months. Love you, Bob. Love you, too. Trap with 3 months. Khalil Jama with 3 months. Going to try to buy a PS5 online tomorrow. Feels like I'm about to walk into a beating by the bots. We're going to have to talk about that pretty soon.
Yeah.
Because we can help you a little bit. Dismantle OS with 17 months. Today is also my anniversary with my girlfriend. I'm glad we could all celebrate it together. Aww. I'm glad I could be there.
Happy anniversary, guy.
Android Doughboy with 200 bits. Thank you so much. So here I am at the Call of Duty Warzone screen where it says install high resolution texture pack. I just said yes. Games as see all. What? I just did this. Or did it not actually?
It sounds like the next generation of gaming is very complicated.
Oh, it's still going. It's still going. I didn't know. I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Call of Duty. I'm sorry about it.
So while we wait, do you want to talk about like actually getting a Series X or a PS5?
Do we have more that you want to see on this thing? I mean, I don't know what else there even is. I mean, the only other thing I could think of is if the settings, the TV output. I mean, this honestly, it feels like I'm using an Xbox One.
Right. I'd imagine there's no real difference between like using it, maybe just a couple settings or like options and whatnot.
Here's an interesting thing. You can't set the display to 1440p. That's weird.
Hmm. Can your display support 1440p?
No. Maybe that's why.
Maybe that's probably why.
Oh, wait, no, it should. Well, yeah, no, it should. It should be able to. But actually, no, I have it set to 120 hertz, though. Maybe that's why. Where would that be?
That should be under TVs.
Now, this monitor cannot support 120 frames per second. Right. So that would be the other monitor.
Maybe that's why.
There was an option under display that had 120 hertz. Yeah, it's just not letting me do it now. So it was there.
Because...
Right.
Yeah, probably because this TV doesn't support it.
All right. Oh, Dan's in the chat. Bob, is the machine good? It's good. I like it. It's very nice. Yeah, let's talk about getting these things.
Okay. Well, don't go to Best Buy or Walmart because they will not be selling these in store.
Oh boy.
And the same goes for PS5. In fact, Sony just flat out said we will not be selling any PlayStation 5s in any physical stores at launch.
Yeah, that is wild. That tells me two things. They don't have enough. They didn't make enough. And they're like, you know what? Forget it. We should probably make sure people aren't flooding the stores this holiday looking for this thing.
According to the PlayStation blog, Sony made this decision in the interest of keeping our gamers, retailers, and staff safe amidst COVID-19 and confirmed that all day of launch sales will be conducted through the online stores of our retail partners. Now, as far as I know, Microsoft has not made a similar statement, but it doesn't look like any major retailer is gonna have Xbox Series systems in store at launch.
Yeah, it's just as hard to find.
Yeah.
Like on Thursday, you're not going to be seeing any PlayStations anytime soon.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a little flipped around here. Well, I got to fix myself.
All right. Why can't I find that article that was talking about how to figure out if your games are optimized for Series X?
What's wrong with
because
you?
There's actually, like, you can go into like the developer code and whatnot, and it'll say Scarlet.
Oh.
Yeah.
I mean, you could also just Google it and don't rely on Scootish to tell you that it's my fault. I knew. I looked him in the eyes and I said, this man doesn't know what he's talking about. You ever do that? You ever look at a guy and you go, this guy's not.
You would not believe how often that happens to me.
This guy, something.
You, sir, are a liar.
Something about this guy, you know, not having it.
All right. Here we go. I found the article. Now it was just the damn thing load because my computer. Method one, the obvious way. Look at your games library. Any games that are optimized for the new console should have a small X or S stamp in the lower left-hand corner of the game icon, much like Warzone had.
Okay. We'll see if it has 120 hertz.
Yeah. Method two, you can also filter your games library so it only shows your next-gen optimized games. So you go to your My Games and Apps, and you go to Filter, and there should be a filter option for optimized for Series X.
Oh, I'm going to do that right now then.
Yeah.
So you go to My Games and Apps.
You go to My Games and Apps. All. Go to
Filter.
Go to your games.
Oh.
Yeah, go to Filter.
Console types optimized for X and S, and it's just Warzone. And yeah, it has the icon.
Yeah.
Why is it Sonic Adventure 2 optimized?
Method 3, in your Xbox game library, hover over a game that you're curious about. Hit the menu button and scroll down to file info. All
right, that's too much now.
Well, give it a try.
Oh my God, I'm here. There's just a bunch of numbers and stuff.
All right. If you look closely, you should. Okay, so you see it says Durango?
No.
Third line, it says Gen Durango.
Yes.
All of the Xbox One games currently installed on this writer's Series X are listed as Gen Durango. That's not too surprising for the games that don't have updates in the pipeline, but it's helpful to see it for those that are released across generations. Watch Dogs Legion, a game that will receive a next-gen upgrade tomorrow for the Series X, is listed as Gen Durango in the file info. Over the weekend, the console automatically downloaded 37.9 gigs update for the game, and it seems to have overwritten previous size. Afterwards, Watch Dogs Legion started showing up when you filter games that are optimized by Series X/S, and it reads Scarlet. So
is Durango Xbox
was
One that's
Xbox
optimized for Series X?
No, Durango is Xbox One.
Okay, so this is an Xbox One game that is optimized for it.
Eventually, theoretically, that should read Scarlet, like I guess after the next update.
Mm-hmm.
But because it has the Xbox One, the Xbox Series X stamp, so it's good.
So, okay, I'm very confused about what's going to happen when I get a game that's only in Xbox X and S. Actually, Falconeer, you know, I'm going to download it. Actually,
yeah,
no, I'm not. I'm going to wait for this to download first.
Yeah. Also, make sure you download Gears.
Yeah, I'm going to download Gears. Download Gears. I'm so happy I don't have to spend any money on these freaking games I'm never going to play. Because I could have just gotten Assassin's Creed. But I decided I don't want that in my life. We disconnected again. Should be
butt
back.
Snack.
Butt snack.
I was going to say ball sack and butt sack, and then I saw a tweet about bug snacks. So it all just like crashed together in my brain.
Okay, so it installed.
Okay.
So let's see what happens. All right, we're reconnecting. We're reconnection successful. All right. Yay. See, all you got to do is.
All right, hey, welcome back.
You get rewarded for staying around, you know?
Yeah.
If you're listening to this afterwards, like most people are, you get nothing. No, you get rewarded with a little bit that the Twitch stream doesn't get.
Yeah, there you go. But at least everything you've gotten so far that has worked on the Xbox One just works on the Series X.
Yep.
Yeah, so it's not, this is again, unlike Sony, which is, you know, it's backwards compatible with PS4, but within, there are limits to it. Good news is Insomniac Games announced that in an upcoming update for Spider-Man PS4, we will add the ability to export your save to Spider-Man Remastered on PS5.
That is cool.
This update will also add 3 new suits from Remastered to the PS4 game. And those new suits are Andrew Garfield's weird basketball suit from the first Amazing Spider-Man movie, a more technically advanced version of the advanced suit from the Spider-Man game, and some weird Japanese robot Spider-Man suit.
Oh, that's Dave Raposa's concept art. Or I guess it's his fan art of Spider-Man. That was okay. That Insomniac was like, make it into a real concept art for us, and he's like, we'll do that. Yeah. It nice. Looks freaking sick.
So that's great that they like got it into their head and they were able to add something like that, because yes, you can play Spider-Man PS4 on your PS5, no problem. But if you want all the fancy bells and whistles of, you know, the PS5 version, you have to buy the game again. Oh no, you have to buy the game again, whether or not that comes with Miles Morales is up to you. But it's nice that they let you at least transfer your save file over. I didn't put this in the keep, but I thought I'd bring it up because it's along the same topic. Apparently, The Last Guardian is only 60 frames per second on PS5 if you play the physical disc version of the game.
That is weird.
If you downloaded it from the PS Store and you play the digital version, it's locked at 30 on the PS5. So if you bought the discless PS5, you want to play The Last Guardian at 60 frames per second, you better hope that they release a patch for it.
That is very weird.
Yeah. It's this whole, like, this is what I mean by, like, Sony. Yes, Sony has backwards compatibility on the PS5, but it's very inconsistent. It's, like, not clear what's supported, what's not. Is anything getting upgraded, or do you have to buy the game all over again? And I'm sure you all saw that PT was originally backwards compatible on the PS5 until Konami told them no.
Yeah. So I just checked all the Warzone settings. There is no setting for resolution or frame rate or anything.
Okay.
So that's a little disappointing. Everyone tells me disable motion blur in Call of Duty. Let me live my life, okay? I'm not freaking Nick Merckx over here. I'm just having a good time. Okay. So what else do we got? Oh, I think we got more notifications. I think Fred gifted a sub to that cyber channel. Thanks, dude. Welcome, Dan. Dan, yeah. Definitely. You tell me Dan didn't have a sub. What a friend, dude. 72107. Thanks for the 100 bits. Bob, are you getting the Mario Game & Watch? Yes. That is Friday. I'm going to have to go to the Nintendo store. That's not going to be a fun time for Bobby Boy. Jin Jukebox says, I agree. It's very confusing. Next gen hasn't always made things easy. Well, I think this generation is needlessly confusing compared to all of the other generations.
Because usually all the other generations was, this is a new box, buy the new box, forget about your old box.
This will play the games better.
Yeah.
And this generation is like, this will play the games maybe a little better. Eventually.
Yeah, because this is the first time both systems are like, they're both backwards we're backwards compatible to an extent.
Android Doughboy with 25 bits. Okay, but motion blur sucks major donkey dick. I'm sure it does. I want a cinematic experience, you know? How big was Warzone? 125 gigabytes if you include the high-res texture pack, which honestly is a lot less than I was expecting. I was expecting a 200 download. How loud is the Series X? And do you think there will ever be better settings customization on consoles similar to PC? Yes, I thought there was in Warzone, but it looks like... I mean, turning off motion blur is more than I ever expected from a console version of a game, you know?
Yeah.
But I'd imagine... I mean, Rainbow Six Siege had a V-Sync option, so like that's pretty cool. If you want to know how loud the Xbox Series X is, here is the microphone up against its fan. Can you hear it? Because neither can I. It's like completely silent. It's like absolutely dead silent. It sounds like it's not even on. So it's great. And the fan, it's got a giant fan on the top and it is blowing out. Like there is hot air coming out of the top of this thing. but I'd imagine that it will eventually get louder as dust settles in here.
Yeah, also probably as more and more games take, you know, demand more and more of the system.
True. Yeah, if I'm playing like Gears of War 4K 120 frames, maybe something will happen.
Well, I mean, like probably like Gears 6 or 7, you know, yeah. Probably.
Yeah, you could see the fan moving. It's spinning.
Oh, wow.
It's going, but you can't hear it at all. So anyway, what else we got, Will?
Well, if you want more confusing cross-gen compatibility, EA has revealed its full PS5 Xbox Series X upgrade plan. PlayStation 5 and Series X are only a week away from launch, and EA has revealed its plan to bring its newest games to the next-gen system. Some titles like Madden and FIFA will receive full next-gen upgrades, while others will just be backwards compatible with some enhancements. In a new blog post, EA has broken down which games are receiving next-gen upgrades and which are just becoming backwards compatible. This being next-gen, it's never simple, and some titles will receive extra features but not full upgrades. So here we go. Madden 21 and FIFA 21. Both games will be backwards compatible on next-gen systems if you already own the PS5 or Xbox One version of either game. On December 4th, existing owners will be able to redeem a free next-gen upgrade for Madden 21 or FIFA 21 for either the PS5 or the Xbox Series X. The upgrade will be available until NFL 22 and FIFA 22 is released next year. Online content such as Ultimate Team, The Yard, Franchise Mode, and Volta Football will also transfer between generations. So you have a year to claim your free upgrade to Madden 21 and FIFA 21.
Why?
We've covered this before. Because, Bob, these are sports games. They don't play by your rules.
That's just let it happen, dude.
I know.
Let it happen till it can't anymore. What's the problem?
I don't know.
Star Wars Squadrons, I want that game.
Yeah, that game looks interesting. It will receive a new frame rate upgrade for the Series X and S, and where players can choose to focus on either better visuals or better frame rate. Frame rate.
That's what I call it when people get really mad when you say that 120 frames isn't a big deal. But now I know that 120 frames might be a big deal because I wasn't even looking in the right place.
Squadrons can run at 1440p at 60 on the Series S and up to 4K or 2160p at 60 frames on the Series X. In performance mode, players can achieve 1440p at 120 frames per second on the Series S and 4K 120p on the Series X, while sacrificing some of the better lighting models and improved visuals. On the PlayStation 5, EA says Squadrons will run with improved lighting and the same resolution and frame rate as on the PS4 Pro. Squadrons will also feature cross-platform play across all available platforms, both current and next-gen. So in that case, the Xbox version of this game is clearly the better version because you're getting 4K visuals and improved frame rate.
Yeah, another note that I didn't mention before. The Xbox One S only comes with a high-speed HDMI cable. The X comes with an ultra-high-speed HDMI cable.
Really?
Yeah, so 1440p at 120 frames per second is the... Oh, no, wait.
That should be possible.
It is the cap. So you can't enable HDR then.
Mm.
You can't have 1440p, 120 frames with HDR. That would be too much. For the little baby cable, unless you get a new cable, and then it'll probably do it fine.
That's interesting that they didn't just put an ultra. I mean, I guess it makes sense because it doesn't really need it, but I would imagine like it'd just be easier for them to just throw in an ultra high speed cable rather than having to sort and find a high speed cable.
It is. I mean, it's the same. The high speed cable is the same that they had on the One X. It is a weird thing. Like, just give it to us, dude. Because all it means is that there's an asterisk on the spec list on their website that says HDR
and
requires cable.
And this sucks too, because if you're gonna upgrade from an X to an X, from an S to an X, and you just want to swap out the systems, it's not gonna work properly. It'll work, but you won't get the full experience because you're not using the right cable.
Yeah, eventually we're all going to need ultra high speed cables. So it would have been nice to get an.
Well, eventually we're going to need to upgrade our TVs in order to use the ultra high speed cables.
Right.
It's supposed to be you buy the system, you plug it in, you play the game. That's why I like console gaming more than PC gaming. I don't want to have to deal with all this other crap.
Also, another thing that'll make you real mad, there is currently zero. Gaming monitors on the market that do 4K 120 with an HDMI 2.1 port. There are zero. There's a lot of TVs.
Yeah.
There are zero gaming monitors. There's some that do it through dual display port, but you can't really adapt HDMI 2.1 to dual display port. It doesn't really work.
Yeah,
I mean, I couldn't find any adapters that do it, but I've tried to go HDMI to DisplayPort before, and it doesn't work.
Yeah.
Right.
Anyway. We got a couple more games. Apex Legends will experience a performance boost on Xbox Series X and S and PlayStation 5 to 1440p.
Not on PS5.
But a more formal next gen enhancement is being planned for next year. So. Wait a little bit for what the true Apex Legends upgrade will be, but they do plan on at least upgrading that for next gen.
I'd be willing to bet that they're going to have like a big update or like an Apex 2 or something huge that they're waiting on.
I feel like a game like Apex probably won't do like a true sequel, but like Fortnite does seasons.
Right.
So it'll probably be like season 3 or 4 or whatever. And they'll just do it that way. The next is The Sims 4, and apparently it's getting Star Wars content.
What?
Journey? Yeah.
Oh, no, I knew this. I was looking at Madden when you said that, and I was like, no, Madden's not getting Star Wars content.
I mean, it might. Journey to Batuu will release on the Xbox Series X and PlayStation 5 and will come with faster loading times and smoother frame rates. The next expansion, Snowy Escape, will also be released on next-gen systems as well as existing platforms and current-gen consoles, PC, and Mac. So that's just really like the bare minimum of next-gen upgrade. It loads faster and it's a smoother frame rate.
Right.
And then these next few games, EA Sports, UFC 4, NHL 21, and Need for Speed Hot Pursuit Remastered are pretty much just backwards compatible. There aren't really any major upgrades to them. There will be cross-generation platform play, and it says Need for Speed Hot Pursuit Remastered is going to run as they would on last-gen systems. So Need for Speed Hot Pursuit and UFC 4 and NHL 21 are just going to be backwards compatible. No, like major upgrades, no optimization.
Okay, so Squadrons seems like a good deal. So does that mean I could download it right now and get 120 frames out of it?
Hold on, let me check the list.
Because like, oh, will receive new frame rate upgrade. Yeah, but that's, yeah. Does that mean it has it? Oh, this is November 5th, so it might.
It's not on the list. It's not on Microsoft's list. And it's not on Polygon's list either. So it's probably not ready just yet.
Bastards.
What about check the store?
All right, I'll check the store.
Yeah.
Mr. Fizz in the chat says, on Amazon, I saw an adapter that converts DisplayPort to HDMI 2.1. Anyone know if that actually works? So here's the thing about that. That is backwards. You wanted to convert HDMI 2.1 to DisplayPort. So I don't know if that will actually work.
Yeah.
Because you want to do it the other way around. Because I wanted to do this. But I wasn't about to drop $1,000 on a monitor that might work. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, I want a new monitor for these consoles, but I want one that will definitely work with these consoles the way that I need it to. Anyway, let's check out, see if this little guy... what am I doing? I'm checking the store. That's what I'm doing.
Wait, I'm checking for Star Wars Squadron.
All right. What else do we have here? Oh, that's it. That's all we have. Notifications.
Yeah.
Oh, no. We got Mr. Fizz said, hey, Wolf Bros. Hope all is going well and you enjoying the new console. Thank you for the 500 bits. That didn't come up in my... Oh, no, it did. I'm just stupid. I'm dumb. How do I use this thing?
I mean, if you've been using your Xbox One, you should know, Bob. I thought you were a real hardcore gamer.
Apparently not. I spilled water on my Xbox One, Will.
speaking of throwing out your Xbox One.
No, you can't have it. Where do I look on here?
I'm not. I don't know. I guess scroll down. See if there's like a... Description.
I'll go back to the description.
Yeah.
Series X/S. It says it on the bottom, but it doesn't say any if like, it's technical details.
Yeah. Wait, go to highlights.
No. Technical capabilities. 4K Ultra, HDR10, Xbox One X Enhanced. One X. But it says Xbox Series X on the bottom.
Yeah. Is this in Game Pass? Or
no.
EA Play?
Wait, go back. It says cheaper
free trial.
With EA Play. Oh, free trial.
Free trial with EA Play. Because don't you have EA Play as part of Game Pass?
It's yours. Thanks for your purchase. This game provides installation... okay, install it. We'll try out Squadrons. Also, I might as well, while I'm here, let's do Gears.
Yeah. I did want to bring up, because a friend of mine pre-ordered the Xbox One. He's supposed to be getting it today. And he said he's actually going to keep his Xbox One hooked up because the Xbox One, when it was initially pitched to us, was as this all-in-one entertainment system, more so than a game console. And everybody, lambasted for it. They didn't like that. But my friend actually used his Xbox One as a media center, and according to him, it worked very well.
Mm-hmm.
And the problem is that the Xbox Series remove the IR sensor, so you can't use like any traditional remote to control it and your TV at the same time.
No, you would need a Wi-Fi remote. I think
you need a Wi-Fi remote, or you'd have to switch back and forth between the controller and your TV remote. Also, the Xbox Series doesn't have HDMI in, so that would also affect a lot of the media capabilities of the Xbox system. All the streaming apps will work. So, like, he's set there, and, like, most of the stuff he has on his Xbox One will transfer over to the Series X, but it's not going to be the complete media experience that he had on the last system. So he, like, for all intents and purposes, he's going to keep his Xbox One hooked up so he can still use it as an entertainment system.
So apparently PDP makes a remote for the Series X temporarily out of stock.
They do, but I don't know if you can use it to also control your TV.
No, because it would just be Wi-Fi, so you probably couldn't.
It can control the volume of the TV, but like changing the inputs and the channel, not so much.
Why would it control the volume?
When you hook, if it's hooked up through HDMI, it can control the volume of your TV. Right. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Tell that man to just figure it out. Upgrade his setup, man.
Pretty much did.
Eventually, you're gonna have to do something. You can't sit there with an Xbox One hooked up.
My other friend asked them. He's like, "Wait, you got an Xbox? I thought you were also getting the RTX 3080." He's like, "Yeah, I want it all."
Yeah, I'm that guy. I mean, who are we kidding here?
Yeah.
Who am I? You know, I got nothing to say here.
Yeah. I did notice Fable Fortitude asks in the chat, Austin Evans and a few others have come out and said that without a new TV with HDMI 2.1 and 120 hertz plus, you won't see much of a difference with these new consoles. What do you guys think of this?
100% true. But yes. Also, I haven't gotten 120 frames to work right. So right now, I think that there's no difference at all. It's faster.
Yeah.
That's it.
I think pretty much at the launch of any next-gen system, there's not going to be much of a difference between last-gen and next-gen.
Unless you know, there's a killer app.
There'll be a few enhancements here and there, sure. But like right now... No, probably not. But honestly, I would say, like, if you absolutely need the full experience, then yeah, get a new TV. But if you just want to play games, the system itself should be fine.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't necessarily think you need to go out and, you know, spend $1,000 on a TV plus $500 on an Xbox in order to get, you know, the full experience. If you want to play the game, just play the game.
Usually in a console generation, there's a killer app like a Halo would have been.
Yeah.
For the PlayStation, it's going to be Spider-Man. Or Astro's Playroom is going to show off the controller.
Yeah, apparently that's like a big deal, that game.
I honestly think that there's just not that much of a jump in these next-gen consoles for developers to be really making anything like truly mind-blowing out the gate.
The jumps from generation to generation have been getting less and less like noticeable and shocking. Like going from Super Nintendo to Nintendo 64 is like night and day, and mm-hmm. going from like PlayStation 1 to PlayStation 2 is very noticeable. But the beginning of the original Xbox 360 era, like there's like a few games that you could tell, but like for the most part, it was just like upscaled ports. And then from like the 360 PS3 to the PS4 Xbox One, there's like less of a noticeable difference between the two. And now it's like even less than that.
You know, at least with those, though, it felt different. You had a new UI, like all like there's a lot. You're like, wow, look at this thing. Listen to that new music you got in the home screen. But these, I mean, at least the Xbox is the same UI.
Yeah.
So it feels like you just got a $400 shoebox that has an Xbox One X inside of it.
Well, even the PS5 UI from all the videos they've been showing is still within the same design philosophy of the PS4.
Right.
It still like looks and feels very similar. The font is the same. The tile layout is the same. The only thing they really changed was that they put all the media apps on a separate page. But for the most part, like, you got the game titles up, you press down, it's all the info on the game that you're looking for, you know. So it's still within the same philosophy of design.
Let's plow through some more of this. What else do we even have here?
I just lost the keep. Sony almost raised the prices of games.
I did hear about that.
Sony discussed raising its game prices even higher before settling on its $70 USD price point, according to Bloomberg. We know that many of Sony's first-party games will cost $70. That's the price tag on upcoming titles like Demon's Souls and Destruction All-Stars. This is a $10 jump in cost of games, but according to Bloomberg, an even higher, even bigger jump was discussed. This report doesn't reveal how much higher Sony discussed, but the idea of going beyond 70 comes from game executives that wish to remain anonymous when speaking to Bloomberg. Based on the games coming this year from Sony, we know that the company settled on $70. But according to a Bloomberg report, companies are not likely to even acknowledge this $10 price jump and will instead opt for more optics-friendly wording that prices will vary by title. It's important to note, however, that not every Sony first-party game will release at $70. Spider-Man Miles Morales is launching at $50, although it is $70 if you get the deluxe edition that comes with Spider-Man Remastered. Bugsnax is also $60. Outside of Sony's first-party lineup...
Bugsnax is $60?
Apparently.
I did not know that. I thought it was like Octodad.
Nah, apparently $60.
Is it...
I mean, it's free if you have PlayStation Plus, but...
Oh, yeah, that's right. Forgot about that. Oh, it's a $60 free game. That's ridiculous.
Mm-hmm. Call of Duty Cold War... Call of Duty Black Ops Cold War... has a stupid name, and that will release at $70, as will NBA 2K21. Also, Godfall, the Gearbox PS5 exclusive, will cost $70. So, games are more expensive.
I'm not sure about Bugsnax being $60 here.
Are you telling me that IGN lied to me?
I think people in the chat are telling you that. I wish the PlayStation website would tell me. You know, wouldn't that be nice?
Is it not even on the PlayStation store yet?
It doesn't have a price on the PlayStation store.
Wow.
Yeah, I don't know how I would find
it. They made a big deal about updating their app. And it's better, but it's also not.
What are you talking about? What app?
The PlayStation app on your phone. Like, it's better in terms of like layout and like usability and the fact that you can get messages in the app rather than a separate app, which was always the most annoying thing about it. But like searching for games is not great because it's not easy to find. A lot of games just aren't on the app.
I recently got the Xbox app, and let me tell you, being able to get things when you hit the screenshot button or record a video, it instantly sends a notification to your phone and goes, you want to download it? And that is the best thing ever, because then you can just instantly put it on social media. By the way, according to Android Central, Bugsnax is $25.
Oh, wow. All right.
So IGN's a bunch of dirty, stinking liars?
I guess so.
Well, if you ain't the granddaddy of all liars...
Point is, most games are going to be $70, and it could have been higher. And if we're being honest, they probably should be higher. $70 is still relatively cheap for like how much time and effort and especially money these developers put into AAA games, and the amount they try to offset it with DLC and microtransactions and whatnot.
Yeah, $70, I think, is, I mean, they had to raise the price. they had to. They were kind of forced to. If they went more than $70, there would be riots.
Yeah.
That would be a problem. $70 is probably the most they could have done. Scootish. Thanks for the 10 months. Fart noise. Ha 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 ha. I hope somebody sent you the clip from before. What else we got? We also have Switch Out Sells NES.
Not to keep dwelling on the next generation of systems, because there's also a Nintendo system out there that is doing quite well for itself. Thank you very much. everything's slowing down. The Nintendo Switch continues to sell incredibly well. According to the company's latest financial briefing, the Switch has now surpassed the lifetime sales of the Nintendo Entertainment System. And Nintendo has updated its financial forecast to show a 50% profit increase by the time the fiscal year ends. Nintendo shipped 6.86 million Switch consoles in the previous fiscal quarter for a total of 68.30 million units, which continues a strong trend for Nintendo since the start of the fiscal year. The continued success of the Switch has allowed Nintendo to raise its profits forecast from 3 billion yen to 450 billion yen, an increase of 50%. In software, Animal Crossing New Horizons has continued to sell well, becoming the second best-selling Nintendo Switch game with 26.4 million copies sold. It trails only Mario Kart 8 Deluxe and has taken over overtaken games such as Super Smash Bros. Ultimate and Breath of the Wild. Overall, Nintendo has sold 456.49 million games for the Switch so far, more than the 3DS and the Wii U life to date, respectively. Recent software releases have also done very well, with Super Mario 3D All-Stars selling 5.21 million units since its September release date. Nintendo predicts it will sell 24 million Switch consoles this fiscal year, showing the system succeeding even amidst the new generation of Xbox and PlayStation. The company's holiday plans are reliant on software like Hyrule Warriors, Age of Calamity, and physical products like the collectible Game & Watch and Mario Kart Live. So Nintendo is doing very well for itself right now. And then an article from Kotaku basically reaffirmed that. And apparently they've also caught up with production now after, you know, a system scarcity during the pandemic. They're now back up to speed and are able to put out Switches at a much more consistent rate.
How high is the NES on the best-selling consoles of all time?
Six?
I think the next one that's left is the Wii, right? That's it.
Yeah.
I'm going to look it up.
Yeah, I'm trying to look it up too.
What's the best-selling consoles of all time? We got... Oh, are we including DS and Game Boy?
See, that's always the trick. Do you include the handhelds?
So we got, where is it? We got Nintendo Entertainment System. Oh, it's pretty low if you include the handhelds. Switch is right below it. Then you got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 above it. So the Switch is 12th right now. But you got the 3DS, the PSP, the Game Boy Advance, Game Boy, and DS. Those are the handhelds. Oh, what do
you
want? The way.
Are you on Wikipedia?
Yeah, I'll put it on the screen.
If you scroll down, there's a second chart that's just home consoles.
Oh.
And it hasn't been updated. Oh, wait, yours is updated. Mine isn't.
No, mine's not updated. Switch is still below Nintendo Entertainment System.
Okay. But yeah, so the PlayStation 2 is still the best-selling video game console of all time. And according to this, the NES is the seventh. So I wasn't that far off. But now the Switch is the seventh best-selling video game system.
If you click units sold twice, it should update itself.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's behind the 360, the PS3, the Wii, the PlayStation 1, the PS4, and then the PS2. Sony crushing it. Wow. I think it's going up there. think it's gonna keep trickling up there. It's gonna be I think it's gonna at least meet the Wii.
It'll be very close. Yeah.
I think at minimum it'll meet. So here's two reasons why I think at minimum it'll meet the Wii. Because families will buy it for each kid.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like you have one in the household. You can have multiple because they could all play it to on their own. The Wii was interesting because they would like put it in old folks' homes. It was used as like a rehabilitation thing that a lot of people were buying Wii Fits and stuff. And we don't really see that right now with the Switch. However, in Japan, we do. The Ring Fit Adventure is like still one of the top selling games there. So there's still potential for that aspect.
Yeah.
Anyway.
I thought Nintendo would be much better off making it a handheld only system. Wouldn't that be so much more successful than doing the hybrid console route? Isn't that a dumb thing to do that clearly people don't want?
Imagine if that guy ran Nintendo. What a weird company.
Oh my God. It would be the most boring ass corporate, like, it's like in cartoons when like, you know, stuffy corporate types take over a company and it's no longer fun anymore and all the walls are painted gray and everybody's got to wear suits and stand up straight and then all of a sudden like they get kicked out and then the whole thing becomes colorful and fun and free again. That's what that would be.
All right. Is the last thing the Google Stadia?
Yes.
All right. It's free Google Stadia. Go get it. If you have YouTube Premium, go get a Google Stadia.
Yeah, if you subscribe to YouTube Premium, go out and get your free Google Stadia, the $100 bundle that includes a Chromecast Ultra and the controller. You can get that for free if you sign up for Google Stadia, the 1 month free trial. Make sure that you put in your phone a reminder to cancel that 1 month free trial. Otherwise, it's $10 a month. Also,
that reminder in my phone will be you.
Wait, were you able to get it even though you have the Founders Edition?
So here's what happened, Will.
Okay.
Here's a little tidbit for you. Okay. I have the Founders Edition. I have it on my spam email address.
Oh.
I have YouTube Premium on my main email address. So now I have two Founders Editions from Google Stadia. Thanks, guys.
Okay.
It's a good deal.
No, this isn't. This isn't the Founders Edition. This is like the regular edition.
Oh, like, you still get the controller and the Chromecast and stuff.
Yeah, but it doesn't. The Founders Edition was that fancy blue color. This is the regular edition. And according to the email they sent me, the color is clearly white.
That's the name of it.
That's the name
Much
of
like
it.
Us, Will.
Yes.
Get the Stadia Premier Edition for free. Okay.
Yes.
It's the same thing, it's just different color.
Yeah, apparently this is on a first come first serve basis, so I don't know what the stock is on this. So if you have YouTube Premium, do it now, and hopefully you do get your system with Stadia. Because it always confused me how it worked. So do you need to pay the $10 a month for Stadia and then buy the games, or can you buy the games without paying $10 a month?
You need to pay the $10 a month. Okay, so the way it's supposed to work eventually is that the Stadia is free,
right?
And you get and you pay for the games individually. Okay. However, for some reason, we're still in this weird beta where it costs money for the subscription. So I'm pretty sure you still have to pay for the subscription and pay for the games.
So it's $10 a month plus an additional $60 in order to play Assassin's Creed Valhalla.
Correct.
Okay.
But it comes with Destiny for free.
It does come with Destiny for free. I did claim that. I also claimed a whole bunch of other crap that I'm probably not going to play, like Power Rangers Battle for the Grid, Lara Croft and the Temple of Osiris, which I'm pretty sure I have on Xbox One, Celeste, which I have on Switch, Hitman, which I've already played, Super Hot, which I have on other systems already. Panzer Dragoon, I actually want to play because I've always wanted to play that game.
You could play that for free?
Yes. As well as your favorite game of all time, Bomberman R.
Yes. Oh, that's the fun edition.
Yeah.
Everybody get this. Maybe we'll do... Oh, no, we can't do a stream because it's YouTube connected, and I don't want to do that.
Yeah.
I don't want to stream on YouTube.
Also, you got to pay money to the developers because of that guy.
Because of what?
Because of that guy, remember?
No.
We talked about
the Stadia guy. You can't stream that. That was a good one.
Yeah, it's a joke because topical.
I will say this is a great controller. It is a really nice controller.
I'm looking forward to at least trying the controller out because it does look like it's be a nice, comfortable controller. Also, my PC controller is an 8-bit Do controller, and I want more like ergonomic controller because I just had the SN30 Pro, not the Pro Plus.
Right. At the very least, if you're not even going to play Stadia, if you have YouTube Premium, you can get a free PC controller.
Yeah.
That's
also
very nice.
A free Chromecast.
True. The Chromecast Ultra.
Yeah.
It's a nice-ass Chromecast. All right. Are we done now?
Yes, we're done.
Okay. Hey, guess what? It's time for Tweet of the Week time.
Do the thing.
I'm doing it. It's just, I don't know why we can't hear it. Yeah, it's Tweet of the Week time. Here it is. We did it.
All right. All right.
We got, this is from RockCock64. It says, man is only mildly concerned upon discovering his Xbox is radioactive. And it is a picture of John from Spawnwith. Look, it's one of his thumbnails.
Yeah. That's funny.
It's him looking at the Xbox Series X, and for some reason he put a green glow around it.
Yeah. You did not put that in the keep.
No, I completely forgot. I pulled it while you were reading one of the stories.
Okay. Because I put one in the keep that I found very funny.
Oh, what did you do?
It's from the Twitter account AITA Reddit. The Am I the Asshole Twitter page?
Oh, no.
And the question is, am I the asshole for not liking how my girlfriend dresses for work? I'll just cut to the chase. My girlfriend is a preschool teacher, and for some reason I cannot explain, she dresses like Miss Frizzle. Like a dress with the pattern of whatever the children are studying. She makes a lot of them for herself, and now including matching masks. The kids love it, and parents seem to think it's great. I don't like the amount of attention she gets, honestly, and I'd prefer it if she come home and change before running any errands.
Oh, like going out like that. Okay.
Yeah. But it gets worse. On Friday, she helped my mom with something after work, and she was still in her weird dress. I have told her before I don't like when she dresses that way, and she tells me I don't have to like it, but I have no right to tell her how to dress.
That is true.
I was upset she went out like that with my mother and told her that my mom said she was embarrassed and to ask that she please not dress like that again if they're going out. I was not expecting her to call my mom and apologize. When my mom asked what she meant, she told her what I said. My mom was furious, explained that she doesn't have a problem with how my girlfriend dresses, and thinks it's great she spends extra time doing things to encourage her students. My mom then yelled at me for lying to my girlfriend and trying to throw her under the bus, and because I was being an insecure jerk. And then, of course, he got into a huge fight with his girlfriend, and his friends think he's being kind of a dick about it, but he just doesn't think it's socially acceptable for an adult to dress like Miss Frizzle in public. So, Twitch, is he the asshole?
I feel like I've never read one of these where the person isn't an asshole.
I know.
They're always the asshole.
They're always the asshole.
But I gotta see these dresses. What if he's looking like the asshole now, but these dresses are really, like, over the top? Like, she's got, like, the whole solar system, like, around her and she's knocking everything over.
I mean, I doubt it's that intricate, but either way, this guy's clearly the asshole.
He's clearly. I was expecting her to dress like slutty for work or something, but then they get into it and she's dressed like Miss Frizzle. Yeah, not what I was expecting at all.
Yeah.
Anyway, that was when we talked to you people.
Yes. We don't do the hashtag anymore, right?
No,
but if you left a comment on the archive version of this over on the YouTube channel, Wolf Den Podcast, we will answer them now. And of course, ladies and gentlemen watching us at home, please start leaving your questions and comments because we will get to them when we are done with last week's questions and comments.
Yes, we got Hamaz Bedir. To me, games with gold is great because I can't afford Game Pass, even though it's great value. Plus, it doesn't have some of the games I want. So, games with gold has helped me build up my game library. How much more is Game Pass going to be with it than Xbox Live?
Game Pass is what, $10 a month?
Yeah, I'm talking about Game Xbox, the ultimate subscription. Like, how much more that's is like, that to upgrade to
that's
that?
That's like $15 a month.
As opposed to, what's Xbox Live, like $8?
Well, Xbox Live you can get for $60 a year. 60 divided by 12 is like $5 a month.
So how much is Ultimate for a year?
15 times 12 is 180.
Okay, that's a significant, yeah, that's a significant upgrade. Never mind. I did not think it was that much more. Nate V. Wolf, hello, Wolf Bros. Hope all is good and that you guys and your families are safe. That was nice. Thank you so much.
Thank you. That's a nice comment.
Josh Torre, I try to watch this each week, start to finish, and drop a like at least, if not comment also. You guys are my podcast, and somehow I learn something new every week from it. Oh,
that's impossible.
This week, you'll learn that hot dogs come in packages of 10, but buns come in packages of 8.
Yes.
One of life's greatest questions.
Yeah, and you will also learn that Rainbow Six Siege is not currently optimized for the Xbox Series
X.
We
all learned that today, Will. A lot of us today learned that, and I'm trying to rush through this so that I can go fix that.
Okay.
Where am I? Ian Pittman. Not to prove their point, but Bob almost said some fighting words when he said the Clone Wars wasn't good. It's not. But then, the show. I'm sorry. I keep forgetting the show is different than the prequel trilogy. But then he said he was talking about episode 2. Now all is right in the world. That, you know, I haven't seen, honestly, haven't seen any of the show because I didn't like the prequels so much. I was like, I don't need this in my life. But
everything
is great.
All the clips I've seen of the show are like very good.
I mean, I've seen YouTube clips and they are good.
Yeah. So as soon as my little one is old enough to start watching cartoons, we're going to sit down and watch all like 1,000 episodes of Clone Wars and it'll be great.
Gamer in Mountain says, you're faking your brother leaving and things were changing has lost you a subscriber. Not a subscriber. Also, I just can't stand you, Bob. With a capital B at the end. You are the most arrogant piece of work I've ever seen. To which some of your loyal viewers said... Oh, no, that's Fred adding. Reply comments.
Yeah.
Goodbye, then. No one will miss you. You're irrelevant and will be forgotten. That was from Jos. And then Mako Fox 22 says, yeah, bro, he left the main channel. He said he would still be on the podcast. They also rebooted the podcast and changed it from the main channel. So I don't know why you're mad. It doesn't make much sense. And then Tyler Davis says, I'm sorry. What's wrong? And I'm going to say, AJ will be on the podcast next week.
Hey-o, Willie gets a week off.
Has nothing to do with this comment. That's just, I was going to have AJ on this week, but I forgot it was the new console. Yeah. So AJ will be next week. Anyway, that's the... all
right.
That's all that stuff. Week. I can't, me faking Will leaving the channel is, was the greatest hoax since 9/11.
Nope. Porkchop78 with a highlighted chat says, "Hey, Will and Bob, what do you think about Ghostbusters 1 and 2? I love both movies and think they hold up pretty well from when they released. For some reason, I seem to like the second one a little bit better, maybe because of the music and story." Both of those movies are great. The first one is, of course, a masterpiece, a timeless classic, an undisputed work of art. The second movie, I love the second movie when I'm watching it. when I'm not watching it, I tend to think about the flaws of it a little bit more. How it's very much a beat-for-beat retread of the first movie. How a lot of the jokes don't really land as well as the first movie does. How Bill Murray clearly seems to just not be as interested as he was in the first movie. But when I sit there and I watch it, I still think in the beginning where they're trying to pretend that they're doing construction on First Avenue with a permit and they clearly don't have a permit is gold. I still tell my friends all the time from the movie, "Suck in your guts, guys, we're the Ghostbusters." And I think that Viggo the Carpathian is one of the best movie villains of the 80s, or rather at this point it was like almost the 90s. But you know, when I watch it, I think it's fantastic. It's just when I don't watch it, I tend to think of all the flaws about it.
Those two movies blur together for me.
Right.
I don't know why. I haven't seen them in a while, I guess.
I think if you watch Ghostbusters and you immediately watch Ghostbusters 2, it really is like beat for beat almost the same movie. Because they go through, like, you know, forming the Ghostbusters. There's a big reveal that, oh, ghosts are real, we need the Ghostbusters. Then there's a montage. Then there's focusing on the main antagonist, which for some reason has a connection to Sigourney Weaver's character. And then there's a big climactic battle toward... Well, no, first they go to jail and have to beg the mayor to let them out. And then there's a big climactic battle with a big giant set piece monster.
Okay. Android Doughboy with 25 bits. I have a Vizio 4K TV that is not high frame rate. I can afford to buy either a 1X or a Series S. Which would you recommend? Does xCloud work on the 1X? How long will Microsoft keep releasing games for the 1X? xCloud does not work on consoles right now, which is really
no.
But
the plan is for xCloud to work on both.
Mm-hmm.
So regardless of which one you get, xCloud will work on it. And these consoles just came out, so you can expect Microsoft to support them for the next like 6-7 years.
I don't think you should buy a 1X right now. I think it's a bad time to buy a 1X. I also don't think you should buy a 1S. I think you should save your money and get a 1X. No, a Series X. Get because you're not going to get everything you can out of the Series S. I hate these names. Because you have a 4K TV. But I just don't think... I think the Series S is a hard... Is a dangerous buy for a lot of people.
Yeah.
It's kind of for impulse buyers, really.
Yeah.
Showtime XIX 2 months. What are 8 games every Nintendo Switch owner needs to own? 8? No. No. Mario Odyssey, Mario Maker, Breath of the Wild,
Mario Kart,
Smash Brothers, Mario Kart, Celeste.
Animal Crossing.
Okay.
Yeah. There you go.
One more. What's a free game? Warframe. There you go. Warframe.
Tetris 99.
Super Mario 35. There you go. You got a bunch.
Yeah.
Anyway, chat.
Mm-hmm.
Gek Gamer says Xbox is for losers. You're just mad because you don't got one, bitch.
Yeah.
Get effed.
Crispy X. How do we beat the bots for the PS5 tomorrow night, Bob?
This is what I wanted to say before, but I forgot. Follow Wario64 on Twitter. He always gives mm-hmm. updates on when things are going on sale. I was actually talking to like the friggin' like a building maintenance guy. He was texting me about buying it, buying the new consoles. And then I told him how. I told him like, oh, look, I sent him like a long text of like, oh, like how to go to nowinstock.com, and you can set up alerts on your computer so that when the console's in stock anywhere, your computer will flash and bing, and you can then buy the console. And that's what scalpers use. So you can use their tools to get yourself one. And he's like, oh, it's going on sale at Walmart at noon. I was like, okay, then why did you ask me if you knew the answer? Right? So go to nowinstock.com, set up those alerts. That's a good way to do it for yourself. But also, Wario64 is a great resource on Twitter. Thoughts on Demon's Souls remake? I don't have any, but I just purchased it because I didn't know it was a launch title. I actually thought it was coming out later. I thought it was delayed.
Huh.
Hey, Bob, it was awesome to see your special guest, the new Xbox. Never owned one and don't care. Oh, hi, Will.
Hey.
Cheap-ass gamer on Facebook/Twitter also posts when they're in stock. That's a good one,
too. Yeah, he's a good guy to follow for stuff like that.
He's good, too.
Wild Fia. Will, did you see the AEW games they announced not long before the podcast started? Looks promising. I did. So there's gonna be three. There's a casino game, which I think is a legitimate casino game. There's a mobile game where you're the AEW general manager, and there's an actual console game that's being developed by Yuke's, who used to develop the WWE 2K games before they decided we don't want to develop these anymore. it's a weird, like, cartoony, more arcadey style, like. Visually, like, the characters look more stylized, and they're going for a bit more of like an arcadey action-based feel, whereas the WWE games the past few years have been basically Sims. So that's very exciting to me. And apparently they got the director of WWE No Mercy on the N64 to work on this. So that's very promising. And a lot has changed in wrestling games over the past 20 years, but, you know, at least it's not going to be, you know, the same as the WWE games we've been getting, because they've been getting worse and worse and worse.
I don't like wrestling games.
I know you don't.
There's any good ones.
That's not true.
Except for Def Jam Fight for New York. Genesis.
Def Jam Fight for New York is the best wrestling game ever made.
I'm going to read this last one skipped over from Mighty Ike, who says, how do I get into graphic design to create logos and make graphics? I would say start with typography. It is the gateway to all of the rest of graphic design. It is very important, especially if you're going to make logos. You got to learn how to make the characters look good and what goes good with what. So start with typography. That's it.
All right.
Thanks for hanging out.
Thank you for tuning in. Thank you for watching us. Thank you for chatting with us. As always, the Wolf Den podcast is every Tuesday night at 8 p.m. Eastern right here on twitch.tv/wolfden. If you can't make the show for any reason at all, we always put the archive version of it up on our YouTube channel, Wolf Den Podcast, where you can watch it on demand whenever you want. If you prefer to listen to us rather than watch us, you can do that as well, because we are also an audio podcast available on anchor.fm/wolfdenpodcast and on your favorite podcast service of choice. If we are not on your favorite podcast service of choice, please reach out to me on Twitter at @WillWolfDammit, and I will make sure it happens.
I got a real butterfly knife, Will.
Nice.
I got a real one. Whoa. Oh, God, it doesn't open. It's like, it's very dangerous. This is very dangerous. Guys, I might stream tomorrow night because I'm not. There'll be a new video tomorrow. And then I might stream tomorrow night also. Don't go anywhere, though. We're going to raid Scootish. And you're going to tell him right in his chat, why did you lie to Bob?
Yeah.
And that's it. Just say, why did you lie to Bob? And if we get
270 people to go into his chat and say, why did you lie to Bob? It will be very funny. go do that. And I will see you later, probably tomorrow. Oh, I hit host instead of... Oh, well. Goodbye.
Bye.
Be our guest! Be our guest! Please be our guest! Bob, thank you for the host with 200 and...